Yeah, do this shit the trendy way. First my money twerk, now it's lifting weights. Money in the gym, now it's heavyweight. They turn up once a year, turn up every day. Yeah.
Mind. Ah, okay. I thought I was. Yes, what's going on? This is the Book of Gabriel. Back at it again, coming at you live from Taiwan. It's Tuesday, March 26, 2024, Year of the Dragon, Gregorian calendar. And we're here to break it down, bring the small picture to the big picture, and the big picture to the small picture. We're going to do the math on this lovely day, a lovely evening where you're at. Shout out to the chat. Shout out to the YouTube, Discord, and Facebook posse. On code 24/7 in the house. On code Silver Surfers. That's my brother in streaming. Check out the Surfing the Apocalypse podcast, where we bring the big picture to the small picture and decode the layers of what's really going on to show you the history of the universe and not get so spooked out about it, how you're involved. Let's go. Hit up the membership for sure. Hit up the membership so we can all do the math together. You know, so it's a beautiful thing to study together and learn together. But today we are on... Shout out to Oncode. Oh yeah, breaking it down real quick with the Boulay news. He had that great Boulay video. He just came out. Check it out on Oncode 24/7's channel. Puff Daddy, his houses were raided in Miami and Florida. Miami, Florida, and California. We saw his son, Justin, get hemmed up by the police, going all tactical on him. Right? Shit was crazy. So that Boule, the black gatekeepers for the true social engineers that try to run this thing we call Earth. So, yeah. And then the other news too, people are going crazy with this Putin unveiling Jesus is black. Jesus is black. Check this out. Well, you see, they got a dark Jesus right there, a melanated Jesus. But here's the thing, though. That's cool, right? But a lot of people want to take that and run with it, especially in the quote-unquote consciousness community, melanated consciousness community. Like, you know, Jesus was black, you know? However, bro, you look at that picture. He's black. He has dark skin, but the features are like a European person. They just painted him chocolate, right? Just so you would become a Christian again. The whole esoteric thing about the Pope worshiping a black Madonna and then Putin revealing this black Jesus with the white features, European features, is the fact that it's an esoteric symbol. The dark skin on these white physical featured artist renditions. It's not that the creation was started from the black man. It's in a way it was. However, before that, it came out the black hole, bro. That's what that darkness is supposed to, on the black Madonna and black Jesus is representing, that these white folks use, is we all come from the black hole of the universe, of the galaxy, the mysterious mama matrix. It sucks you in like a big vagina. Look at CERN. It's a big vagina. They're trying to reverse engineer. The black representation of the gods is the black womb of creation, the black hole that started this universe. But people want to get all prideful instead of just hearing the truth. I mean, I don't care about your feelings sometimes when I'm telling you the truth, bro. Yeah. I'll go 24/7 to keep whites happy, to curb violence. Here we go with the comment. The Magical Negroes, though. Yeah, that movie, The Magical Negro Consciousness Secret Society movie. which seems like a psyop, you know, of all that wokeness and getting you all colored crayon box out instead of like unveiling the using your awareness to be aware of the mysteries of the world that you're a part of, right? Getting locked in that color matrix program. I'm good on that, man. I'm good on that. But let's do this right here. Happy to have everyone there, especially on code 24/7. Yeah. Let's get this Putin shit out of here. Let's see. Excuse me. Yeah, so Book of Gabriel, chapter 27, verse 2. Soul trap, what happens when you die? I don't know. Do we continue to exist after death of our body? And if we do, what would that look like? What would that really look like? It definitely would seem like a bad thing, right? When you die. So in this live stream, let's analyze some of the possibilities and try to figure out whether they're good or bad. I mean, you die and that's it. You're nothing, allegedly. You cease to exist. Death is the permanent end of experience. It could be an internal nothingness. That's the most straightforward scenario in terms of death. Death is the end of life. So an idea that there is life after death is obviously false. Our fear of death is biologically programmed into us. And to an extent, it's unavoidable. However, maybe philosophy can help us reason our way out of the situation that death is bad. Well, you might say that someone dying is bad because they're not around. That person was there and now they're not. However, I don't think this is actually the key when we're talking about negativity of death, about or that it's bad. Here, walk with me on this one right here. Let's try this thought experiment for a second. Put a one in the chat if you're with me on this thought experiment. Come with me right here. As this handyman goes by, peddling his services outside. Live from District 13, Taiwan. So let's do this thought experiment for a second. Let's say your best friend in the world is this guy named George. And George spends years studying astrophysics, and he's about to go on a expedition to the Andromeda galaxy to do research there for the rest of his life. You can't follow him there, and once he leaves there, there'll be no way to communicate with him ever again because it's so far, which is a bummer. But let's say instead of leaving the rocket, George is dead. His rocket explodes immediately after launching, killing him instantly. The outcome is the same From your perspective, George is gone and you'll never see him again. However, the situation where the rocket explodes definitely seems worse. So the issue isn't just that George isn't around anymore. Well, you feeling, you walking with me? There's something important about the fact that George died. So instead of thinking about George, let's bring it close to home, bringing the big picture to the small. Let's think about, you're the one that died. Death is bad because you won't exist anymore. And personally, you really love to exist because that's all you know. Existing is probably epic. It's bad for you to think that you're going to die and you won't exist. So who would it be bad for? It's easy to think that when you die, we enter into a kind of blackness or void, and we place ourselves into this space, liminal space, as if we sink into this pit of nothingness and we're trapped there forever. We end up in this strange realm with no thoughts, no sensations, no experience. And this is something that we somehow witness for each of our eternities. But this doesn't really make sense. This is reifying and defining nothingness. I had heard on a Larry King interview, the comedian Norm Macdonald once said that he came to a realization that death and yourself will never intersect, just as long as you're here and death is not. But as soon as you think about death, it's a bad thing. Is a motherfucker, man. But does it really have to be like that? Let's see this take, some other philosopher's take on death, and let's do the math on it.
Quote, "So death, the most terrifying of ills, is nothing to us, since so long as we exist, death is not with us. But when death comes, then we do not exist. It does not concern either the living or the dead, since for the former it is not, and for the latter are no more."
That's where Norm Macdonald probably got that quote. So death, the most terrifying of ills, is nothing to us, since as long as we exist, death is not with us. But when death comes, then we do not exist. It does not concern either the living or the dead, since for the former it is not, and for the latter no more.
Okay, but does it actually have to be bad for me for it to still be bad? Things can be bad in different ways. Putting my hand on a hot stove is bad because I'm experiencing the pain and the badness directly. Burning my hand is immediately and intrinsically bad. But let's consider a different scenario. Let's say I spend my evening scrolling TikTok. The whole
wasting your time. Unless you're trying to do some research with it. But even then, you need to take a little break.
Time I'm mildly entertained. It's a neutral experience. But what if my friends had also invited me out that night? I was scrolling TikTok alone in my room, instead of cracking a few cold ones with the boys, which would have been way more fun. That time I spent scrolling wasn't intrinsically bad, but it was bad compared to what I could have been doing instead.
That's like death. Like, I mean, if you didn't know about it, it probably wouldn't mean anything to you.
This example illustrates the deprivation account of why death might be bad. Not existing isn't bad in an inherent way, but it's bad compared to all the fun, meaningful experiences I could have if I continued to exist. Okay, but let's take this
fear of missing out syndrome, FOMO,
non-existing thing a little further. What if I never existed in the first place? Would this be bad? Well,
you actually don't exist. The false sense of reality that you have, as soon as you're born, you're given a name, a gender, and a social security number, and a place of birth, and a location, and a nationality. When in a little while before, you never had any of that. So in a sense, you can say your whole existence is based on a false sense of reality. And especially if on top of that, then you put the false sense of self on top of that, you're lost.
It seems bad for me because I do exist now, but this runs into some major problems. Think about all the possible people that could exist. Let's look at our current generation right now. Let's say there are about 5 billion people who could reproduce, half men and half women. Each man could technically create a new person with each woman. And beyond that, every single egg-sperm combination of each of those pairs would also create a different person. If a different sperm won the race, I wouldn't be the same person I am now.
Literally, when that sperm hits the egg, that is your father shooting his cosmic space shuttle into the void of space in the womb of creation. And it hits that egg and it becomes a space traveler that just hit a planet. And that's the first death. After that, there's 6 more. So you're basically a sperm right now that's waiting to move up the rings of Saturn into higher and higher states of evolution.
I would be my sibling. As a rough calculation, that's 2.5 billion women times 30 years of reproduction times 12 eggs times 2.5 billion men times 50 years of reproduction times a conservative 365 ejaculations per year times about 40 million sperm per ejaculation. That works out to this number, 15. That seems like a bit too much emotion. I'll put nothingness in B tier.
Let's see these tiers of the afterlife. So nothingness is a B tier, okay. Heaven, what is heaven? What are we going to place heaven on the tier of the afterlife?
Ranking heaven in a video like this is a little tricky. Religions that describe a heavenly realm are usually pretty vague about what it's actually like there. It's described as this perfect, beautiful place with no pain and suffering, where we can live in bliss and worship God for eternity. But is this kind of immortality something we actually want? The deprivation account might say yes. Not existing is bad, because you'll miss all the fun. So if we live forever, that would be ideal. Well, not exactly. At a certain point, there might not actually be anything interesting for existence to give you. You wouldn't be deprived of anything. Imagine a classic idea of heaven. We all turn into angels, and spend eternity singing psalms together or something. Singing psalms is probably pretty fun to do for a while, but doing that for all of eternity seems a little excessive. What kind of life would be worth living forever? This isn't just 100 years, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, or 1,000,000,000 years. This existence has no end. There are some things I love doing. Eating lamb vindaloo, solving Minesweeper puzzles, listening to Beach House, whatever. But after the first 100,000 years of doing that, it would probably get a bit stale.
It would be, because he's onto something. There is no end and there is no beginning. Both these concepts are consequences of having a memory that allows you to reflect back on the past. There's a first memory, and then there's the last memory you have. We existed before, after, and in between, past, present, and future, and beyond all concepts altogether, we exist. See, these perspectives, they come and go. However, awareness, consciousness remains. You're silently witnessing everything without judgment. It's the false sense of self that thinks that there's someone there to judge. So you can familiarize yourself with this by setting an intention to focus your attention on something of your choosing and to try to remain aware of it. Try to remain aware of how your attention will jump all over the place regardless, and keep noticing and gently nudging your awareness back into your intention. I'm trying to do these exercises right now when I'm doing my side missions. So you can do this exercise. Do this as long and enough as you can when you feel like it's enough. And eventually you'll come to appreciate the space in between thoughts. There's always something happening. Subtle changes in vibrations, pulsations. And you see this, especially if you're whacked out of your mind and hyper aware of your body. You see this. You can hear your heartbeat. You can feel your breath. This is the perfect focal point for your attention, your breath, as it's a sensation that both feels fully under control, yet it also happens by itself. There's no doer required. I'm telling you, I'm leading you down the rabbit hole onto the other side right now, because this is effortless being. That's where you'll find your eternal bliss. That's heaven. Heaven ain't hard to find. Tupac said it. You'll never really feel down. However, in accepting the downs as a natural expression of the entire spectrum of emotions and states of being, knowing that everything is transitory and can in some ways be appreciated and accepted for. Let's see what else this philosopher has to say and do the math on it some more with them.
Okay, well, let's say you take a different approach and you try to make the most of your time. You spend 1,000 years writing novels, 1,000 years painting. You learn how to play every single instrument at an expert level. You will always run out of things to do. At some point, you will have done it all. You might be able to fix this problem with some kind of amnesia system. Let's say you get bored after about 1,000 years of doing stuff. At this point, you start to lose your memories and forget what you did a few hundred years ago. By the time you're at 2 billion years, you could barely remember what you spent your time doing as a young 100 million year old angel. At this point, you've changed completely. You have different tastes, a different personality, and you spend your time doing things that you wouldn't imagine doing before. But is this really worth it? There is continuity between the young angel me and the old angel me, but is it still really me? I don't even remember the previous me existing at all. My personality is totally different too, and I'm probably hanging out with different angel friends. I don't think I'd want something like this. Alright, but maybe instead of having to try to do interesting things or entertain yourself, you just experience complete bliss for eternity. Maximum pleasure. This seems appealing at first, but it also reminds me of something. There was a study where they attached electrodes to a rat's brain that released an intense burst of pleasure. They hooked this up to a button that the rat could press whenever it wanted. As you might expect, the rat just sat there pressing the button over and over until it died. But I'm not a rat, I'm a human. And it might sound arrogant, but I somehow feel like I'm above that kind of thing. I'd probably really enjoy the intense bliss for the first few thousand years, but then I'd start to think to myself, is this all there is? Okay, so here's a heaven I think would actually be desirable. You can hang out there as long as you want, but the door is open. Once you're satisfied with all the things you've done, you can peace out. This scenario seems pretty good. The problem is, we don't really know which of these situations heaven would actually be, and some of these cases are just totally made up to fix the boredom problem. I think the standard understanding of heaven is just that you live forever in a perfect place. If that's the type of heaven we're working with, I'm not a huge fan. C tier.
Okay, so when I think of heaven, I think about how to get there. How are you going to get to heaven? And it goes, me thinking about this, it goes into this whole concept of the afterlife. It leads me to really think about that as humans, we are embarking on this journey of reincarnation, you could say. This is a thought experiment. We're traveling through these different levels of history, you can say, that are encompassing the past, present, and the future. And in this cyclical journey, we're experiencing the different roles of everyone that's ever been. You were that poor man, you were that wealthy man. You were beautiful, you were ugly. You were oppressor, and you were oppressed. And through this process, we're trying to comprehend the full spectrum of human existence. Consider this, like, consider the complex persona of the Austrian painter. You know the Austrian painter, right? Hitler. A figure driven by narcissism and obsession with purity. He ultimately got his goal of genocide, and he inflicted immeasurable suffering upon millions. But according to this thought experiment, the Austrian painter, in his different incarnations, during his reincarnation cycle, would experience all the anguish he inflicted upon others. Therefore, fostering a deeper understanding of the consequences of his actions. And if you keep walking with this thought experiment, similarly, those who perpetuate harm would in turn undergo the same suffering they inflict. That's interdimensional karma right there, cosmic karma. I mean, you're experiencing karma right now in our everyday life, cause and effect, which causes you to see the interconnectedness of beings that take up this reality we're all sharing. And this is how we get to heaven. It's this realization of our interconnectedness. The understanding that we're all bound by a shared human experience serves as the catalyst for our collective growth and evolution. It's only when we transcend the barriers of division and embrace empathy. This is the cosmic consciousness, the heart consciousness. Empathy as the cornerstone of our interactions that we can truly flourish as a humans, as a human family. So in order to do this thought experiment we're doing about what happens when you die, we're kind of putting on the hat of these beliefs of reincarnation and karma and the concept of linear time, which these frameworks, they do, they're philosophical frameworks, which help us explore the complexities of the human experience and the interconnectedness of all the beings we interact with every day in the squished reality. Give me a one in the chat if you feel me, if you hear what I'm saying. Comment from Uncode 24/7. Solar or soles of shoes. It's the etymology. Gets them every time. The soul, the eye in the sky, as you can say. The sun worshipers, right? And this hell, this constant, we're going to go into hell now, the hell tier. One love. One love, wild man ninja. Good to see you, bro. Yeah, this concept of a hell definitely has a lot of the modern day origins in the Hebrew scriptures. And hell is literally a place that, according to their scriptures, that you can find only during the day of judgment. It's not a place that you go to that's here like right now. There's hellfires and people burning in hell right now. No. If you read the scriptures of Christianity and also Judaism, you'll see that it's a place that's birthed during the afterlife, during the final judgment, right? And then that's what we're talking about, what happens when you die, aka the afterlife. So let's talk about where the hell fits into the tier of rankings of the afterlife matrices.
Inferno, the first part of Dante's Divine Comedy, is probably the most famous depiction of hell. It has 9 circles, filled with horrible punishments like boiling in pools of blood or being submerged in frozen lakes. Even Buddhism has different types of hells with intricate punishments, like the realm of the hungry ghosts. There are a lot of different depictions of what hell would actually be like, so I won't spend too much time on the details here. At least in the biblical tradition, it's important to understand that hell is a very complicated issue. From what I gather, a lot of the colloquial understanding of hell comes from medieval art and literature, and isn't actually...
Little Hieronymus Bosch paintings right there, the hellscape. Which Travis Scott, in his Astral World Riot murder ritual a couple years ago, has his heavy Hieronymus Bosch hell symbols going on in there.
Actually directly based on anything the Bible says.
Open up a portal, literally.
You ever sat down and read this thing? Technically, we're not allowed to go to the bathroom.
Some people believe that when the Bible says eternal fire, it might not necessarily mean eternal torment. It could be that you had a soul, but it gets destroyed if you're a sinner. That would make this situation similar to nothingness. You don't experience suffering for eternity, you're just denied entry into the afterlife. But for this video, I'll consider the most common interpretation of hell, some kind of eternal suffering. If that's hell, I don't think my placement here will be particularly surprising. It's safe to say that suffering is bad. It's like burning my hand on a hot stove, like I mentioned earlier. We have an immediate, absolute aversion to the conscious experience of suffering. It's a fundamentally negative state of being. And not
only... Yeah, I burned my hand when I was 3 years old on a hot iron. And ever since then, I stay away from fire as much as possible.
Not only does suffering suck, but our damnation would, in fact, be eternal. When I talked about heaven, I came to the conclusion that immortality itself comes with downsides, even if you're free to do whatever you want, or experience intense bliss. Here, all the bad things about eternity are combined with a constant state of suffering. Bottom tier.
Yeah, who wants to be a part of that, bro? That's hell. This is similar to the prison planet. A template for the afterlife about how we're living in a simulation, allegedly, right? And how some people think that there's no lessons here on Earth, and that the Earth school's a scam, and it was made up by interdimensional parasites who pretend to be higher beings to fool humans into an ongoing reincarnation cycle. These people believe no one learns anything. And once you die, you are all subject to a savage memory erase process. The so-called higher beings meet you after death, and they're actually psychopathic archons. These people actually think that the universe is a slave farm that was set up to siphon life force energy from you because you're such a powerful spiritual being having an experience here on Earth, and you just taste so delicious to these archons and inorganic beings, and you fall into their trap of giving them negative emotions and even contemplating these thoughts I'm sharing with you about how we're living in a prison planet that you have to escape. But you're stronger than that, right? You're not going to let that affect you. So let's see some of the other philosophers' take on what happens after you die and who's there watching.
Our souls undergo a life review that lasts for 21 Earth days.
So when you die, this narrative is saying that your soul goes through a life review, huh? 21 days, right? I've heard the Buddhists, Hindus say 180 days is when the soul is deciding what will happen next, what it will travel next. The 21 days could also be a reference to the Day of Judgment, when you'll be judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about where will you go. Will you go to the beautiful levels and blissness of Jannah, heaven, or will you go to Dante's Infernos in real time? 21 days it takes, right? That's why a lot of times these cultures, they leave the body undisturbed. Buddhists do that for a certain amount of time before they cremate it.
As our spirits depart our earthly bodies, we instinctively gravitate toward a brilliant light, the source of the reincarnation cycle. We then have a full lifetime review.
Ooh, you get on this the black hole, the mama matrix, where you got spit out of, allegedly. And you have a life review. Who are these beings right here? They don't look too friendly. All shady, right?
Following this review, which evaluates our accumulated karma, we face a choice.
Sounds like the Day of Judgment right there.
Either re-enter the cycle of reincarnation or reconnect to the ultimate source and consciousness of the Creator. Then,
so you get a choice either to jump off the wheel of karma or join the Creator, become a co-creator, which you already are right now. Like who's coming up with this? Who are these watchers that are supposedly watching you when you die, quote unquote die?
Upon choosing to incarnate again, we choose our life paths and make soul contracts with people we will meet in the physical realm, such as our parents, family, and friends. Contrary to the conventional notions of heaven and hell held by some religious institutions, karma is the only power that determines our paths. And on this path, we have spirit guides that are with us, who are also known as guardian angels. Our actions, both good and bad, are meticulously recorded in what quantum theorists and spiritual mediums refer to as the Akashic Records, akin to the Christian concept of the Book of Life. Throughout our lives, we are accompanied by at least four spirit guides who provide guidance and support. These guides...
Spirit guides, I know in Islam they say that we have angels that's recording everything that you're doing around you. So when you do get judged in this life review, they have content to use at your trial.
It's become our welcoming party upon our passing. This explains why many people who have near-death experiences report seeing familiar faces and feeling comforted. Once the spirit separates from the physical body, the silver cord is severed and one is drawn toward the radiant light, accompanied by a guardian angel or spirit guide, often a friend or relative. This light serves as the energy source leading to the life review and reincarnation cycles presided over by the Lords of Cycles. These beings, not judges but reviewers, work under the Creator's laws and guidance. In this reality, Earth functions as a school where we acquire knowledge about emotions and limitations, serving as data collectors. Advancement requires learning from our mistakes, and failure to do so results in forced reincarnation in similar or lower states. It is said by many ancient Taoists that when you die and see the bright light, most are drawn and head towards it. However, most do not look behind them.
Yeah, that's the thing. There's whole communities that believe that there's a possibility that when the human souls are trapped on the Earth's reincarnation cycle, and there's plenty of evidence that they feel, these people think, that is out there that supports this notion that after physical death, human souls are time and time again wiped of their memories and sent back to Earth to live more physical lives, and they're sent back for reasons that do not benefit us. And like I said, these people believe that there are entities that are interested in farming your energy, true inorganic energy beings, meaning that if you take this theory full circle, that the Earth could be possibly a soul farm or a prison planet.
Behind them is the universe, and you can choose to go there instead of the light, and that will return you either back to your current life or back to the creator and source of the universe. Dolores Cannon, a renowned hypnotherapist specializing in past...
Dolores Cannon, who perpetuates the reincarnation trap philosophy. It's interesting because is it real reincarnation or not, or is there malevolent or benevolent motives behind it? The point is, it's still involved in this equation of how the universe is creating itself constantly in the history of it, which is the number one priority here on my broadcast. I'm trying to piece together and enjoy myself while I'm doing it. What is the history of this universe?
Spent nearly,
and its mysteries,
half a century uncovering the intricacies of death and reincarnation through her clients' experiences. These clients, who had experienced and regressed to their lost memories of death rather than near death, shared valuable insights into the afterlife and the ongoing cycle of reincarnation. The ultimate goal of reality is to manipulate energy, gain full awareness of Christ consciousness, and resolve all karmic debts. According to Cannon's findings, there are three primary destinations in the afterlife, each determined by one's vibrational frequency. The lower astral realm is inhabited by souls deeply rooted in negativity, often unable to move beyond the third dimensional earthly life.
That sounds like I'm taking now I'm interested. I'm on a roll now. I'm thinking about the whole prison planet matrix template philosophy. And not, it comes to mind Gnosticism too. They believe a lot of this stuff. But you hear about these so-called reptilians who are both physical and astral beings. And the evidence does show that they've been heavily involved in manipulation of mankind for thousands of years and are responsible for setting up soul traps around the planet with the help of extremely advanced technologies. Now, bear with me, walk with me on this one. How there's energy grids around the planets that serve multiple purposes. And one of the main purposes is to project this grandiose tunnel of light in the proximity of people who have just died in order to lure their souls into it. It's a scam if you take this philosophy to the core of. This is the same tunnel of light that so many people who have had near-death experiences have reported seeing on the other side. The soul may be under the impression that the tunnel is going to take it to heaven, which we were taught through our Western Catholicism. Or perhaps it's going to take us, if you're in New Asia, to higher planes of existence, depending on your awareness that you cultivated here, your power. Some evidence shows, however, that when the soul enters the tunnel, its memory gets wiped and the soul is put into another body here on Earth. This is where you get the whole reincarnation program. I call it the Reincarnation Act, in a sense. This tunnel going to the light acts as a bait. And to make a, let me think of an analogy of it. Imagine a fisherman with his fishing rod, and he throws in the bait, which hides the hook and the fish, and gets trapped in it when they bite. We get tricked and trapped by the tunnel of light in a similar way if we aren't aware of its trap. So in this case, we're the fish. The inorganic beings, some of you guys like to call them reptilians, are highly intelligent, highly advanced technologically, and they lack empathy, which makes them dangerous. Just like those of us who use our reptilian brains too much and not our higher mind, our frontal cortex, have a quest for power that sometimes gets out of hand and ends up destroying all those around them and as well as themselves. These inorganic beings see themselves as controllers and farmers of humanity in the same way we see ourselves as controllers and farmers of cattle here on Earth. That's the reason the inorganic beings, want to keep you here. Because they need you for food. They live off you energetically. When people go through any kind of suffering, these entities feed off your lower frequency emotions, such as fear, pain, grief, anger, jealousy, rage, anxiety, lust. Because these are all low vibrational beings that require low vibrational energy in order to survive. This is their junk food. These archons, as the Gnostics and Rudolf Steiner refers to, feed off your fear and anxiety. And some of the people that make these videos, I think, are being controlled by archons, or at least influenced by them.
This includes murderers, addicts, and those diagnosed with psychoses. Many, when they die, remain unaware of their death and seek to re-enter living bodies, unable to escape their destructive mindset in the lower astral realm. They seek the negative sensations they had in their life and are lost and stuck. Eventually, they become disinterested of not reaving the physical sensations and head back to the reincarnation cycles to pay their karmic debts and learn life once more from the beginning. The middle astral realm resembles the concept of heaven, described as a beautiful and vibrant place where one can shape their reality based on their desires. The surroundings are filled with various vivid colors, breathtaking landscapes, and the opportunity to reunite with loved ones. This realm is perfect and indescribable. However, some souls eventually seek more profound experiences and move on to an upper stage of reality. The souls that choose to move on, progress to the upper stage of reality, connect to libraries of the Akashic records within the Source. These libraries contain rooms where souls can observe and study various aspects of reality and the universe, informing their choices for future incarnations. An example would be like watching a film or series. It is entertaining, but it would be more entertaining to actually live and experience it. The next step involves interaction with the Elders of Cycles, a council that advises you on your lives in the universe, but does not dictate the paths you choose.
This definitely seems like a repackaging of the of how religious beliefs and programming are an obstacle in getting into people's true purpose in life. A lot of religions have programmed you to believe that at the moment of your death, a spiritual judgment type of scenario will take place. The biblical judgment, for example, or in the Quran, the final call. This spiritual judgment scenario will be expected of you to give your authority away to these beings, guides, or angels, or God. And they are letting them decide your fate. Look at the God thought, measuring your heart against a feather. So that when your time actually does come, you won't even question these beings and what they're doing with you. Instead, you will simply accept whatever they ask from you. And because everything will seem to be going on as planned, because since that's how you were programmed by your religion to believe what will happen when your physical life ends.
After physical bodily death, a comprehensive life review occurs. Every action, word, and interaction is presented objectively from the perspective of those you affected. For instance, if you touched someone in a good way, you will experience what that person felt. And on the other hand, if you hurt someone, you will experience what they felt. This process aligns with the teachings of the Emerald Tablets by Thoth, the Atlantean priest king.
There you go, Thoth right there, man. And more power to you if the Egyptian religion and philosophies helped you, or any religion helped you become a person that's at peace. But do be aware that some of these so-called entities, organic and inorganic, that show themselves when you pass on to the next dimension, remember that some of these entities take advantage of the fact that you've been continuously conditioned to believe in an afterlife savior who will take you to heaven if you're a good boy or girl. Even if you're an atheist, when you see this God or Jesus figure like right in front of you in the astral realm, you may start to have a second thought about what you thought about religion and God back on Earth. And you will most likely end up accepting what these entities want you to do, because your perception of reality can change in an instant in a shocking and surprising scenario like that.
Who referenced insights on the Elders of Cycles, mentioning these beings are neither alive or dead, and are life reviewers responsible for overseeing the universe's cycles, emphasizing the everlasting nature of the universe's laws and consciousness under the Creator.
You see, because religion has also given you the sense of being a guilty sinner who has to worship, obey, and pray to a certain God, depending on your religion, in the hopes of an afterlife and salvation. But the way I see it is the real salvation is not coming from the parasitic entities who pretend to be our creators. It's coming from ourselves, who got it from a higher source. You know, and in order for this realization to happen, we have to become aware of what actually awaits us when we quote unquote die, so we can use our free will to put an end to this vicious soul trap, this reincarnation cycle. A comment from Master Creator, my side mission co-pilot. What's going on, man? Trap your soul with a spider web, man. You want to act fly? Representing the Big Apple, it's Fly Guy, flying you all the way to the top in this journey on the soul trap. What happens when you die, quote unquote die? Cryo, shout out to Ohio and beyond. You think you're Einstein? No, I know I'm Einstein and everything in it. Yo. Shout out to the True Life family.
Albert Einstein's principle of the conservation of energy aligns with the ideology of the spirit being separate from the body. His quote being, "Energy cannot be destroyed, it simply transfers. When a being passes away, the energy that animates them is no longer there and gone. However, the energy that animated them continues to exist."
Yeah, I mean, the real power in the infinite creator, God, who has nothing to do with any religious movement, is already within you. You are a source of energy. We are the saviors we've been waiting for. We don't need to give your power away to anybody, unless you want to, which most people are. And they love that false sense of self. What's going on? Comment from Uel Adams, the human metent supercomputer. Parasite or pair of sights? I see them everywhere. Parasites. And then I gotta be really on my square and rotating on my circle to not get caught up in some of these videos are like high powered nowadays, these times we're living in, and giving the little layers of peeling off the reality of what's really going on with the mysteries. They're indoctrinating you in the old religious programming. And don't get me wrong, I love to learn about religion, and it did serve its purpose in the evolution of the human consciousness. However, just think about this. If you're born somewhere in Europe, in North America, South America, wilderness of North America, for example, and the main religions of those areas tell you that God puts you on this earth to live your life, and at the end of that life, there will be judgment. God will then decide whether you go to heaven or hell for eternity. However, if you're born in another area of the world, such as the Middle East or India or any country or religion excuse me, region, religion. You see that? See what I did there? Any region, man, in which the main religion is either Buddhism or Hinduism, these religions all teach you that life after death, there's reincarnation. No heaven or no hell. So why is that the place where you're born and on this planet? It dictates a certain belief in something so important, such so that our existence is predetermined beyond physical life. Will random experiences really going to dictate what's going to happen to you, to each one of us at the moment of our death? What's going to happen when that happens at the moment of your death? That's something to rotate on, because your last moment is spent sucking down the fact that life is bereavement, loss, pain, and betrayal. Then you open your eyes and you can't recognize the person holding you, but it feels good. You don't realize who's feeding you, but it feels good. You don't realize what's being said by these people, but it's clear that you're being cared for from your mother and the nurses and the midwives. So you start to forget about loss and pain, betrayal, and start feeling confident that life is all about unconditional love and growth. Your caretakers, they give you another warm bottle or titty from mama, and you start to forget all about your last ride through the process of spiritual alchemy, aka reincarnation. Comment from Yoel Adams: religion is twisted out of altered experience of few people so they can control the experience of the many. That is the ultimate pyramid spiritual scheme, multi-level marketing, with the biggest salesman being the priest class. Master Creator, whoever's in power will dictate how your seed flowers. This is why I truly believe that if you really want to get the most out of this incarnation, this life, make sure you work on yourself and find out what your philosophy of life is, so you can be so confident and secure of what you want that you know who is part of your tribe, your family, your community, and they will love you and you will love them. But first, you got to love yourself and get rid of this false sense of the self. Like I said, as soon as you're born, you're given a name and a number and and everything else that comes along with it. And until the day you die, unless you wake up from your NPC-ness, you truly believe that's really you.
As the spirit undergoes a transition, our bodies are only vehicles and clothes we put on and take off. Alan Watts, a renowned English writer and professor, celebrated for his teachings on Buddhist, Taoist, and Hindu spiritual philosophies, delivered a profound and transformative speech that was recorded in the 1970s. Alan Watts says in the speech, "I wonder what you would do if you had the power to dream at night, any dream you wanted to dream, and you would, of course, be able to alter your time sense and slip, say, 75 years of subjective time into 8 hours of sleep. You would, I suppose, start out by fulfilling all your wishes. You could design for yourself what would be the most ecstatic life. Love affairs, banquets, dancing girls, wonderful journeys, gardens, music beyond belief. And then, after a couple of months of this sort of thing, at 75 years a night, you'd be getting a little taste for something different. you would move over to an adventurous dimension. Well, there were sudden dangers involved in the thrill of dealing with dangers, and you could rescue princesses from dragons and go on dangerous journeys, make wonderful explosions, and blow them up. Eventually, you'd get into contests with enemies. And after you've done that for some time, you'd think up a new wrinkle to forget that you were dreaming, to think it was all for real.
Absolutely. Shout out to Alan Watts and Wild Man Ninja with his bass Alan Watts impersonation. He's definitely a method actor when he's actually probably channeling that Alan Watts. I love that whole Grandpa Alan Watts. That's what I call him, my spiritual grandpa. When he goes into talking about dreaming. Because the places you go when you dream isn't just in your head. It's literally a quantum level with a completely different set of physics to the material plane, 3D. All the planes, the physical, the astral, etheric, and what's the other one? Casual, exists within this quantum world. Kind of like how the planets and stars exist within our universe, but remember that they exist in kind of a different set of quantum rules, so they can literally be layered over the top of each other in the same physical location, but they have time trajectories that run in completely opposite directions. So both when you dream and when you quote-unquote die, you go somewhere within this quantum universe. The only difference being that when alive, you seem to have some kind of energetic tethering to the physical plane that brings you back to it, back into it. It's the same as with astral projecting, which we did the math on that 2 weeks ago. In astral projection, you are basically just turning your consciousness into the frequency of the astral plane. You become the astral plane. The astral plane and the energetic realms were basically just set up as a type of installation layer that's set up around the quantum boundaries of the physical universe so that we don't venture too far outside the quantum space. So keep walking with me in this thought experiment. So in dying, you need to be able to navigate beyond the lower etheric capture planes, which is incredibly hard to do if you have never been able to induce lucid dreaming and be awake in your dreams. Wake-induced lucid dreaming is somewhat of a misnomer, as technically one isn't actually dreaming. It's really more of a transference of the consciousness into the quantum realm. Comment from Cryo, you mean blue flame. If the blue flame is here, I salute you, brother. Comment from Big Chill. Growth is spontaneous. Matter precluding cataclysma. Back to the bill. Let's do the math on this.
And to be anxious about it. And then, because it'd be so great when you woke up, then you'd say, like children who dare each other on things, how far out could you get? What could you take? What dimension of being lost or abandonment of your power? What dimension of that could you stand? You could ask yourself this because you know you would eventually wake up. Then you would get more and more adventurous, and you would make further and further out gambles as to what you would dream. And finally, you would dream where you are now. You would dream the dream of living the life that you are actually living today in this very moment. That would be within the infinite multiplicity of choices you would have of playing that you weren't God. Because the whole nature of the God, according to this idea, is to play that it's not. So in this idea, then every living being is fundamentally a fractal piece of God. Not God in a politically kingly sense, but God in the sense of being the self, the deep down, basic, whatever there is. And you're all that, only you're pretending you're not. One day, you're gonna wake up and say, wow, that's me. What you are, basically. Deep, deep down, far, far in it, is simply the fabric and structure of the simulation itself. The captivating concept within simulation theory revolves around the notion that particles possess the ability to transition in and out of existence, traversing diverse dimensions.
That sounds a lot like how Buddhism teaches that reincarnation is an endless cycle of suffering every time you go through these dimensions. The wheel of samsara that can only be broken by you achieving enlightenment. So in other words, we're all stuck in a reincarnation cycle where we are bound to continuously suffer one way or another, life after life, until we spiritually wake up and break free from the reincarnation cycle. Or just go back to sleep.
For example, James Gates, a theoretical physicist, discovered error-correcting code within the equations of string theory resembling computer code. This revelation has led some to consider the possibility that our universe's laws and constants are part of a programmed reality similar to a computer, and all beings are cords connecting to the universe, which is a like computer source.
I mean, these beings that these philosophers and scientists are referring to, and like, I don't include the scientists and philosophers. I'll include my psychedelic buddies, my sorcerer psychedelic buddies here in the chat and beyond, because the perspective of the psychedelic experiencers definitely have a say in a. And we need to hear what they have to say about the soul trap and what happens when you die, because many people who have done psychedelics report a certain kind of experience indicating that this place is either a prison planet or a soul farm, that we are actually being farmed energetically, which confirms information coming from other sources that have nothing to do with psychedelics, such as Gnosticism, past life regression, remote viewing, and also the CIA operative Robert Monroe in his experiments of the out-of-body experiences in his research. I love those pictures and representations from Alex Gray and his mantis parasitical beings who are literally look like they're harvesting energy from the mediums of the tripper, as we say, in some of his epic murals and whatnot. I remember Chris Contamo, rest in peace, his stories about cat-headed mantis body alien parasites who were monitoring the space-time continuum when he was tripping out of his mind on Dimitri. Comment from Big Chill, until you learn your lesson. Comment from Yuel Adams, a supercomputer. Many systems try altering the reincarnation cycle to have more memory experiences when in the experience of existence. Yeah. I mean, David Icke, that's what got me started in a lot of this whole deep dive of consciousness back in 2010. And that was, oh shit, man, that's like 2010, it's like 13 years ago. more than 13 years ago. But David Icke, for the last 30 years, have been saying that he's been investigating what's happening, and his research dives into how there are inorganic beings controlling our society from the shadows. The people that are controlling are trying to control the government and the world are doing it from the shadows, and they're influenced by inorganic beings or archons. And David Icke uses the terminology of interdimensional race of reptilian beings that have hijacked the earth and continuously manipulate global events in order to keep humans controlled and in constant fear. Look at Ukraine. Look at Gaza. Look at Deep East Oakland. Some of these places with extreme violence and sorrow are probably like buffets, hometown buffets for some of these inorganic parasites. Shout out to Master Creator with the comment. David Icke partied with Diddy. Yeah. We spoke on that, reset that news story. Diddy compounds in Miami Beach and California have been raided by Homeland Security. His son, Justin, and others have been arrested and taken in by the tactical team of the federal government because allegations of human sex trafficking and drugging. So those rumors that we've all heard for years have been letting us know something that has definitely been unveiled during this full moon in Libra we're going through right now. They put the spotlight on the roaches, you can say. Just think about the entities, if we're on this thought experiment of entities controlling or trying to control our reality by siphoning energy from us. Just think about people like the Boule member, Puffy, how he was influenced by some of these inorganic beings. Okay. Let's get back to this video.
This intriguing phenomenon extends even to our thoughts, nestled within the synapses of our brains, as illuminated by the principles of quantum mechanics. A striking illustration of this phenomenon is found in the genesis of quasi-crystals by quantum physicists. These multi-dimensional crystals, including a remarkable eighth-dimensional quasi-crystal, cast their shadows downward into lower dimensions, ultimately congealing into a spherical form. This phenomenon bolsters the idea that our universe may merely be a projection originating from a higher dimension, giving rise to the intriguing hypothesis that we inhabit a holographic universe. In summary, various sources and teachings from around the world converge on a fundamental truth. We are all fractions of the Creator, split into a Google of beings in the universe to experience this 3D simulation matrix. The truth is that we are all fractions of God and a part of one consciousness playing that we are not. We are multidimensional beings who live after the illusion of physical death, and our actions in each lifetime are rewarded or penalized through the karmic cycle until we have learned all our lessons of this reality, ultimately returning to the source of reality from which we originate.
That sounds all good and fine and beautiful. I want to take that into my perspective. And if I am going to daydream, which is a luxury at this point, because there's so much work to be done, that's a beautiful perspective. But there are people who work for the government. And you know how a lot of y'all love to hold them as gatekeepers into what you believe or don't believe. What comes to mind is John Grace, who's the former CIA director, subsection director, who wrote about the soul reincarnation trap and about how the earth is a prison planet. And this is interesting, and it goes back to when we talked about Aleister Crowley and his Oswald AWOS workings and about how his sketch of the secret chief Azwa looked like a damn gray alien. And I remember John Gray saying in one of his papers how it's the gray aliens who wait at the light when a human being dies. The human being is then recycled into another body and the process begins all over again. Hence, this is where you get the light in the tunnel you see at the death trap. And these grays, and you see it in the movie Communion, and if you read the book too by Whitley Strieber, these grays are standing over you. And I've had dreams like this where I've had sleep paralysis and I've experienced this. They scan. It seems like they're scanning you and they wish to recycle and use what they can when you're near death. And when you're dying, the gray aliens, as what Grace said, they project the person's image into the white light. And the image waves go deep into your cerebellum. And if you choose to follow, you can be trapped and sent to another incarnation of their choice. These entities, according to John Grace, are viewing Earth as a big farm. Right? This is fear-mongering too, because in the end, like, who's experiencing these soul traps and pain? What's really behind the consciousness, right? I think what most people are holding on to is this false sense of self that they take as quote unquote who they are. But what is the soul? That's another build we're going to have to get into. So let's go. Comment from Newell. Some say reptilians in the past here once learned to keep memory through the cycle. And now even as a person, they might still hold on to ancient species mindset. It's probably buried in there, deep in there, which you can regress. Well, that's another soul trap too, a scam, as some of the prison planet escapees. Not to say you are, but like what I've read over the last couple of years about what they believe happens, about the from the perspective of past life regression and hypnosis, because that's a really that's a really big thing right now. Hypnosis, past life regression. And some of these takes and interviews from people who have had past life regression say how they've seen how the reptilians feed off us energetically while we're physically here on Earth, and how they try to manipulate us into accepting reincarnation when we die by pretending to be beings of light in the astral realm. You can read some of these sessions from this Italian hypnotherapist. I'm trying to think of his name. I'll post it later in the video. Right. So, comment from you. Well, more dimensions than just the one of the site, for sure. Probably is. And then what we're seeing with the site is not actually what's actually happening, too. It's our interpretation of it, each human being's interpretation of it. Shout out to Mr. Cuevas, Edward Cuevas, aka Creature K. Real talk, bro.
If you enjoyed this video, we invite you to join or subscribe to our channel to unlock exclusive perks and access member-only content, where we delve.
Yeah, I mean, this guy's video was good and all that, but my stream is better. So hit me up on the membership, or if you like, keep following here on Book of Gabriel on YouTube. I really enjoy having you here. Because we're just doing the math on this stuff that I normally would do by myself, but it's more fun to do it with like minds or or even people who are just love to learn new things and add on and be creative. So let's see this other top tier ratings of like we started off about an hour ago about rating the afterlife and the top tiers. What are the top and bottom tier? And the bottom tier we decided would be the nothingness, the void, that template of reality of the afterlife. That's the bottom tier level. And then now we're going to do the math on the hell where that fits. Oh, actually, the ghost, the astral realm.
Ghosts, apparitions, phantoms, specters, spirits.
Ghouls.
Son of a bitch.
Surprisingly, something like 18% of Americans believe they've had an encounter with a ghost. If you were a ghost, you would be condemned to exist in the realm of the living. No clipping through surfaces and witnessing your loved ones going through their lives. Maybe this is some kind of limbo state before you go to some afterlife. But for now, we'll just consider the ghost life. The only way you can communicate with people is with a Ouija board, which, by the way, is created by Hasbro, the same company that makes Monopoly and Connect 4. Your only line of communication to your relatives is through 13-year-olds trying to induce a paranormal experience at 3 a.m. I feel like that would get pretty frustrating. Maybe you'd be condemned to haunt a particular location for some reason. Maybe you were murdered in a particular house, and now you have to spend eternity shifting around items on the counter to freak out whoever happens to live in that house in the future. Maybe some guy is being too much of a greedy capitalist on Christmas, and you need to visit him one night and show a straightforward scenario. Death is the cycle of life and death. But some now will just consider the ghost life. The only way you can communicate with people is with a Ouija board, which, by the way, is created by Hasbro, the same company that makes Monopoly and Connect 4. Your only line of communication to your relatives is through 13-year-olds trying to induce a paranormal experience at 3 a.m. I feel like that would get pretty frustrating. Maybe you'd be condemned to haunt a particular location for some reason. Maybe you were murdered in a particular house, and now you have to spend eternity shifting around items on the counter to
Hey, thanks, UL. Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe this is all like fear tactics, but is it better to be a ghost and lose yourself, memories and gnosis, your knowledge, while everyone else dies via the light? We can remain merely as a ghost or an extension. And this is maybe an improvement from reincarnation. And I think maybe those people with lower vibrations may not be able to cross the energy net and become earthbound ghosts. However, this is all heavy speculation. And maybe that's what it's meant for. Enjoy your life here and now. The key is getting that rainbow body, as we spoke on in the Indigo Children episode of Surfing the Apocalypse on Saturday night we had with Onco 24/7. So yeah, I appreciate you for saying that, UL. You know what? I think it's, man, I'm gonna have to do part two because I gotta do a main mission right now, get my ass to the dog park to let these puppies live their best life. And I'm living my best life. I'm doing it for me. I enjoy watching them play and have fun. So we're going to have to put the cap on this. Eye in the sky, soul trap, what happens when you die, when they die. I'll say they die. Words are powerful. So final comments. You, Adams, would you say a person that can astral project is a ghost? I would say they're a ghost with a heavy layer of matter on top of them. Yeah. Let me see. Comment from UL. Enjoy your walk. Thank you, brother. And I really enjoyed having everyone here. UL, the human supercomputer. Big Chill, Chilly Chill. James, aka Wildman Ninja, the Master Creator 23. Appreciate you, fam. Creature K on code 24/7. All the homies. Appreciate you all, man. Live your best life. You're here now. We're contemplating death and life here as we're on a constant journey of rebirth. That's always happening, right? Find your eternal bliss. We in the building for sure. Find your eternal bliss on this Libra moon, full moon, which is a synchronicity because all my buddies are here, Libra, the other. You know, making things beautiful, putting the cherry on top. Accept the good and the bad as a, you know, natural expression of the entire spectrum of emotions in this state of being we call being a human. Know that everything is transcendent, especially when you're down. And then give appreciation for everything, right? Do the math on yourself. Always be introspective while being kind, right? And don't get punked. Lames will hurt you. Don't be lame to yourself. I can go on for days. Yeah, but thanks for coming by. This has been the Book of Gabriel, chapter 7, verse 26. Soul traps, what happens when you die. And in the coming days, which the next build will be on this Thursday night, will be on Dune and Race Consciousness, aka the Jung's Collective Unconsciousness. So we'll do the math on that. See how it affects us here and now. On Sunday night, Wilderness North America. We're going to do Side Missions Episode 2, Master Creator 23. And I will be doing the math on Reddit's most disturbing and mysterious posts. And then on Sunday night. On Saturday night, we'll have another episode of epic episode of Surfing the Apocalypse with Oncode 24/7, the real deal Morpheus. We'll do the build on reincarnation again. And if we're living in a simulation, but you know, so in the coming days, we'll see you next time here on the Book of Gamers.